Hello and welcome back to Amazing Mind. If you've just joined us, I have as my second guest, Dr. Mitchell Mays. Now, Dr. Mays is an honors grad of HMI College of Hypnotherapy. He is also on the faculty of Cleveland College of Chiropractic. And this is one of his first stops on his book tour for his amazing new book called The Mind Gate. Please help me welcome my guest, Dr. Mitchell Mays.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you.
Dr. Mays, tell us about your book.
Well, with 36 years in practice, I had been noticing all these years there's a common condition of people coming in to see me with pain syndromes, and that condition was had a name put to it when I read a book by Alvin Toffler called Future Shock, and the name was Tranced. And that was apropos, and it's actually a social epidemic at this time where people are tranced. There's so much information overload throughout the world in our society that people are actually escaping into the state of hypnosis, waking hypnosis.
You know, I don't really know exactly what it means that you are tranced. And all I do know is that many of my clients, and I'm sure people out here, our clients come in with a low level of sadness, a little bit of fear, a little bit of confusion, and they seem to be like sleepwalking through life. Can you explain how this is happening?
Yeah, exactly. When we escape into the state of hypnosis during our waking state, or this walking hypnosis, as you say, I call it unauthorized hypnosis, we are subject to or suggestible to a lot of negative things around, including and especially our own negative thoughts. And our negative thoughts make up about 70% of our subconscious mind. So that's a lot of negative thoughts. And that actually destroys happiness, according to Dr. Dan Siegel, who has the MindSight Institute at UCLA. And he calls it mind wandering.
Well, this sounds very negative. How can we stop from going into an unintentional trance?
Well, that's the key, and that's what I go over in the Mind Gate. I have an entire chapter that is titled How to Dehypnotize Yourself. And it's all about that, to stay out of that trance state during your waking hours, so-called waking hours, as Dr. John Kappas would say. And I start off all my clients and patients actually with making sure that they get regular protein at intervals of 2 to 3 hours, and that keeps the blood sugar to the brain on a even keel, so their brain doesn't go into a panic, fight, flight mode, which will send them into a trance state as well.
Well, when you talk about protein, I know so many of my clients, maybe people here, anybody here a vegetarian or a vegan? How do we get, there you go. How do we get protein into our system every 2 hours?
Oh, there's so much vegan protein available right now. I mean, if you don't want to prepare meals, there's many pre-prepared meals and smoothies and bars and snacks, vegan snacks everywhere. If you go into any of the major markets now in the health food section, there's tons of vegan protein snacks available that you can carry with you in your car or put them in your children's lunch boxes. So it's there.
Okay, so one, we need to come out of trance with protein every 2 hours.
Every 2 to 3 hours, that's correct.
What else?
The other thing that I teach my patients and clients, and I go over all these in the book in detail, is to do deep breathing, because when we're in a trance state, we're in anxiety, as you pointed out there too. So we have these negative thoughts and feelings going on, which creates more anxiety, and we become shallow breathers. So we're breathing into the chest, and pretty much, at least in this society, we're pretty much shallow breathers anyway. Between freeway traffic and, you know, corporate jobs and that sort of thing, we're constantly in anxiety. And what that does is create a condition called oxygen debt. Too much carbon dioxide in the body actually puts the brain into panic mode as well, and it escapes into fight flight again. So it's this constant going into hypnosis all day long. So I teach people how to breathe down deep into the belly. It's called diaphragmatic breathing. Some call it belly breathing or yoga breathing, but I have them do this for 5 minutes, 3 times a day. Once when they're laying down, when they wake up, after they go to the bathroom, go back to bed. That's also when I teach them to visualize and meditate. But to breathe deeply into the stomach, as if you're sticking your stomach out. Everybody try that actually right now. If you sit on the edge of your seat, you can't do it sitting like I was sitting. You have to sit so the belly can actually expand. Now, a lot of people have problems with this because they don't want to look bad. Nobody wants to walk around sticking their belly out. And that's part of the Western culture. So Breathe down deep as if you're breathing into the belly like you're inflating a balloon in the lower stomach. And hold that just for about a count of three or four, and then release a little more slowly than you breathed in. And I have them do that for 5 minutes, 10 minutes if they can do it. And what that does is it offsets that carbon dioxide oxygen balance, so it goes back into a more normal cycle, and it activates the parasympathetic nervous system, which is our relaxing nervous system. And this brings us out of trance. I discuss other things like moving your body, and there's other techniques as well.
So far we have eating, breathing, and moving.
Correct.
I like all three.
They're easy.
But we do it with intention.
Right.
What else?
Well, for instance, let's say that you're finding yourself in a bad mood. When you're in a bad mood, you have to realize you're probably in trance in a bad mood, unless, as an example, let's say you're in fear. Now, if you're not being confronted with a fearful situation, but you're feeling that emotion of fear, you can pretty much bet, and as hypnotherapists, you know this, there is a subconscious program running that's been stimulated. So to get out of these lower tone or emotions, you can actually get somewhere, get alone by yourself, and you can move that energy quickly so that you can reestablish a homeostasis, so to speak, or a balance in your emotions.
So can I ask you an example? Because sometimes it happens extremely quickly. As a matter of
fact,
I would say all of these things happen very quickly. I'll give you an example. Let's say I had my protein every 2 hours. I was breathing, my belly breathing, for 5 minutes in the morning. And then I'm moving around. As a matter of fact, I just finished playing tennis, and I wander into the Starbucks that I never go to. You know the Starbucks you never go to. And there is my entire tennis team, but not me.
Yes.
Now, even though I did everything I could to stay out of an unintentional trance, immediately I have strong negative emotions. I have, I'm running an old program. I have abandonment, betrayal, and shame. Why have one when you can have all three? Now what do I do? Came on very suddenly.
Often it does come on suddenly, or it seems to come on suddenly anyway. Going into Starbucks, it's possible you didn't have your protein completely, or maybe you do have an oxygen debt, but let's say that does happen, and you want to change it up real quickly. You don't want to react that way. You don't want to feel bad. Go ahead and go into the bathroom in Starbucks or back into your car and call up your anger, because anger is a very, very powerful emotion. It'll move things around in your
body.
Wait
a second, wait a second. I don't want to pull up the exalted emotion of pride or the exalted emotion of gratitude. Why do I want to pull up anger?
Well, the exalted emotion of pride is, first of all, kind of hard to get a handle on. Mm-hmm. And you're at that stage, you're in a negative cycle, if you will, a negative feedback cycle with the subconscious mind. So you need to stop that cycle, move the energy around so that you can move your emotions up into a little more positive emotion. So what I do is, this is called the emergency brake in my book. And what it is emergency brake. Think about putting on the emergency brake. You're going to halt it quick. Is you go somewhere where you're not going to be seen, hopefully, and clench your fist if you have to. Feel the anger inside your body. Call up that anger. Everybody can call up anger if you think about it enough. If you have to, shake your body to call that anger. Or you can even, if you can't be heard, you can say, get off my back, get off my back, get off my back. And what you're doing is you're actually directing that anger toward those negative programs, not to people, not to another person, not to an animal or anything else that's going to be hurt from this, but to the program. You're letting the subconscious know, no, that program's not okay. That's what our anger is for. It's to put in our boundaries, even with our own subconscious mind.
So we're actually saying, get off my back, to our old programming.
Correct.
Okay, so I moved all the energy around. I realize those are old programmings, probably stemming from, I think, junior high lunch table. So now that I've moved through it, what do I do next, Dr. Mays?
That's a really good question. And so once you've moved through it, you feel the energy moving. Anger has a way of making us feel more powerful, of making us feel like we're in control. We can call up our anger. It's a way that we put it in our boundaries. It's a way we stop aggression. And so now you have some adrenaline kicking around in the body. You're feeling better just from that alone. And you're able to think about, well, you know, I don't want to be with them anyway. I mean, it's like, you know, so what will happen is your thoughts will naturally shift to a more positive thought train or a thought feedback loop. It just automatically happens. You don't even have to think about it.
I have one last question for you before we end. You call this book The Mind Gate. Mm-hmm. What's a mind gate?
Well, the mind gate is the critical area of the mind between the conscious and the subconscious mind. And as we all know, as hypnotherapists, it naturally disorganizes when we go to sleep. And whatever information is in that critical area drops into the subconscious mind. And it also is open when we wake up too for the first 15 or 20 minutes. And that's not a problem, generally speaking, unless you're going to bed watching TV news or with negative thoughts on your mind. And I address that too in the book. The problem is when we go into unauthorized hypnosis during the day, because if we're exposed to a lot of negative during the day, which most of us are, and it goes in and it goes disorganizes and that information drops into the subconscious mind without being critically analyzed and vented out, that's when the problem arises. So what it's about is becoming the gatekeeper for your mind gate. And that's what I call the critical area, the mind gate. You need to watch it.
So we only want to open up the mind gate with our intention and for our purposes.
That's correct.
Dr. Mays, everyone's going to want to get a copy of your book. How can we get it?
You can get my book in Kindle format, Nook format, at Barnes & Noble, Amazon. It's actually at 25,000 booksellers. So
that's
pretty
a lot
much
of
anywhere.
Books. All right. And that's all over the world, isn't
it? That's all over the world, yes.
Well, if you would like to get a copy of the book, or if you would like to see Dr. Mays in his private practice through Skype, through telephone, or through FaceTime, you can reach Dr. Mitchell Mays through hmigrads.com. It appears we're out of time for today. I want to thank you so much for being on the show. I want to thank everybody in the studio audience, those of you watching at home. But please stay tuned. We have a lot more coming up for you on Hypnosis TV.
Thank you.